reflect that a quorum is present, we're going to have the invocation and the pledge of allegiance. I will ask everyone to stand at this time. Ms. Elmore, would you give the invocation?
Let us pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for today, Lord. Thank you for all the many blessings you allow us to enjoy each day, our Father. Thank you for waking us up this morning, our Father. Encouraging you to get out and do the work we need to be doing, our Father, pleasing you. Our Father, we assemble here this morning. We just ask you to be with the midst of us commissioners and all decisions to be made today, our Father, that will be pleasing to you, not us, Lord. Look for you for guidance, our Father. We just ask you to be with the men and women overseas fighting for our freedom, our Father, and their loved ones, Lord, and take care of them. Ask you to be with this country in a whole and be with the ones that are running for president, our Father. Lay on our hearts, our Father, that the ones you want us to vote for, Lord, they'll go and be voted in, our Father. And just ask you to forgive us for we fail you in a shortcoming and guide and direct us. Ask all this in Christ's name. Amen.
Join me in the pledge of allegiance to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Please be seated. Well, this is a rarity. We got more people in the audience than we have up on the podium for a change, Mr. Barton.
Yes,
and
sir.
That's good because people are interested in county government. And we welcome you here this morning and we appreciate your interest. At this time, I will entertain a motion to adopt the official agenda.
I make a motion to adopt the official agenda.
I have a second by Mr. Barton. All in favor of the motion?
Aye.
All opposed? Nay, there being none. I would like to ask for unanimous consent to move the Proclamation for Disability Employment Awareness Month to the front of the agenda.
It's number five.
It's just number five.
I make a motion.
Okay, we got a motion to take up.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. Okay, Ms. Sybil.
Yes, sir.
Proclamation, please. We have a proclamation for the disabilities work here in employment awareness for this month. So at this time, I'll ask for a motion that we adopt this proclamation.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and second to adopt this proclamation on Disability Awareness Month. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. There being none, motion carried. Now, will a representative from the group please come forward and take the proclamation? Would you care to say anything?
Yeah, I'd like to thank you all for recognizing individuals with disabilities that are seeking employment in our area. On behalf of the Governor's Committee, we've been in operation for more than 25 years in the area, and October is always the time of year that we recognize the need for individuals with disabilities in the community, and our committee services those individuals. And we'd like to invite everybody on the 27th. As usual, we have our annual banquet at Shaw Industries, and we've been there again this year. We'd like to have all of you come to attend, so you should be looking for an invitation in the back.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, all of y'all.
Thank what you do.
If y'all care to leave, that's fine, unless you won't sit back through this board meeting. At this time, we'd like to give our public official an opportunity to speak, and I see that we have our representative, Mr. Mike Jones, in the audience. I'm going to ask him if he would like to say a few words or not.
I'm here supporting the proclamation.
Okay. Thank you. Let's see. Ms. Phillips. We have our probate judge. Ms. Phillips, you have anything?
Ms. Who?
Brooks.
No, I don't have anything. Thank you.
Okay. Sorry about that slip. I was looking for Mr. Meeks.
He's right there in the back. Sheriff, you have anything?
You got anything?
At this time.
Any other public officials? I don't think so. At this time,
I'd like to say something to the sheriff right now. He don't use a setback over where we lost you, sheriff. You use that over here.
He's undercover.
That's what got
he's trying to hide on us.
That's what got me sort of flabbergasted. He was not in his usual place. And I couldn't find him, so. But he's in undercover work this morning.
He is.
Okay, this time we're going to take public comments from the citizens, and the first person up is Mr. Eric Johnson with Point A Park, and would you please come to the podium, please? And
morning, everybody.
Good morning.
In front of you, sorry for the short notice, I just dropped it off in front of all of you this morning. We've been working on this water issue out at the park, and I think most of you are aware that most of the quotes that are coming back in from the contractors seem to exceed $200,000 to correct that problem. So what I have done is come up with a basic alternative to it. I'll try to run through it quick, give you an overview. Essentially what I'm proposing, that I've talked to Lynn and I've talked to Kevin about, is to take half the park, kind of redevelop that part of it, and pull a few. It's basically the park's broke off into two sections. You have a north section and a south section. The north section is the problem area where we have all the utility issues. So what we're proposing is to kind of do a reconfiguration of the southern part of the park, pulling some of the sites off the grid that are in the northern part of the park that are causing us problems. And I think what we can do by that is it'll lighten that overload on that electrical supply on the north side. It'll improve the sites on the southern side, and then what we can kind of do is, you know, kind of push down the road a little bit those improvements that are needed on the north side. And what we'll try to work out is if we can start to get the people in and using those 15 southern sites, then we can start to individually, we'll bring power in and slowly start to do them instead of doing them all at once, just kind of piecemealing them and doing them one or two at a time. The total cost for it that I've estimated, what it would basically do is it would bring, using in-kind services from the park personnel, in-kind services from the county. And then if we can talk to Power South about the expense of it, to bring the proper power service we need to those southern sites would be just under $2,000. Materials to redo the water and the power at the 15 south sites would be just under 10. There's a little bit of space that we're waiting on some quotes for materials such as dirt and backfill and sand and things like that that we need, but I think we can get that stuff from the county a lot cheaper than I can go get it myself.
So the situation when the power, we do know we have a safety issue with the power.
Correct.
And this is a proposal in order to begin to correct that.
Yes, sir. And not spend, you know, $200,000 or $300,000 on it.
I think all the commissioners have a copy of his proposal, and as you know, with his lease, he has to get permission from the commission before any work can proceed out there. So depending on what you want to do with this, I know you probably don't want to make a decision today, but I think he's just putting this forth for food for thought. And y'all can let Ms. Sommel know what your comments are, and at a later date, we can take action on it if it's deemed necessary. But you need to point out that if some improvements are not done, the park will not be able to stay open because of some safety problems. Any other comments from the other commissioners?
No, I don't have any now. Looking over this.
One thing, our administrator and our attorney met with Power South just last week, week before last.
Week before.
And they haven't made a commitment yet of what they're going to do. Is that correct at this time?
That's correct. We're waiting back for another appointment with them to meet with a group.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That's one thing we had talked about. Mr. Johnson met with us before,
right,
to see what they would do before we made a decision what we might do.
Now, I've actually talked to a couple of people from Power South. They came to the park. So the feedback that I'm getting is that do they want to cut a check for $200,000 or $300,000 or $400,000? They don't. Do they want to be involved to correct the problems? They do. So it's, but from their side, they would like to be more on a providing materials and things like that for the improvements. That's where I came up with this idea, is so that if we all work together and someone buys the materials and then we all pitch in the labor, we can get it done for a fraction of what those other improvements are. And then once I can actually get the park to where it's got generating some income, I don't have a problem doing the other sites. We can work together again to do those, to help cut those costs, because to me, I mean, you know, $200,000+ is a lot of money.
Yeah.
And I think that we're showing by this proposal that with a little bit of pitching in from both sides, we can get it done for a much more reasonable amount of money.
Got another question. When y'all left Metal Power South, did they give y'all any kind of data that they may get back with y'all?
Supposed to get some estimates together and talk with Kevin and see if we couldn't meet with people that are knowledgeable of what needs to be done, and they wanted a spokesperson for them as well at Power South to sit down so that it would be productive. Maybe we could come up with something where we can work together. So it was I thought it was a productive meeting and very hopeful considering how it began. So I'm assuming we may need to just get an appointment, Karen.
Yes, I
had Kevin involved, and I don't know how much involvement you've had with it yet.
I've spoken with Gary, had some involvement. Went up there to take some measurements, get some estimates and stuff. And he's already got that really close. I just need to look over there. I believe this to be the truth as to labor materials and stuff. And then, you know, I talked to Karen a little bit about some kind of services. I understand that the county commission needs to approve us to do that.
As another update, that NRCS, National Resource Conservation Service, has done the topo of the area. They have not turned it into the Soil and Water Conservation District yet. And with that topo, we'll be able to see exactly where our drainage problems are. And when that's available, I'll give Mr. Wallace a copy of that for him to make his comments as to what he might be able to do for us in kind services there. So I'll be having a meeting with the Soil and Water Conservation District next week, and I'll see if I can't get that finalized. Anything else?
Thank you.
Okay, at this time we are going to hear from Otis and Teresa Richardson about Prestwood Bridge Road. Please come to the microphone.
Question on that would be Mr. Duggan.
Just a car salesman.
That's right.
Yes, lovely.
Well, we better watch it if you're a salesman. Okay.
We got a small group of us here today to talk, you know, about the unpaved portion of Prestwood Bridge Road. Our road is probably one of the most heaviest traveled dirt roads in the county, we think, and it's getting difficult to navigate. We estimate there's probably 200 residents that live around there in that area, you know, on that dirt road and off of it, you know, from branching off dirt roads that are around there. And many of them drive miles out of their way to avoid the worst portions of this road. You know, they have to go up through River Falls and around to get home or wherever they're going. When it rains, we have a big problem with people mud riding and making the roads a bigger mess for those of us who live there. If there's any way y'all could help us stop this activity, we would help greatly appreciate it. I know that Mr. Harold Elmore, he's had some experience with folks dirt road riding and mud riding on his road too, and it's hard to stop them. I mean, you can't stop them a lot of times. We're also concerned about the ability when it rains and gets rough like it is it's like a washboard effect when you ride down the road. You know, if an ambulance had to come down there to get somebody to get to the hospital, it'd be rough on them. It's the same way with fire trucks. We know that parents have to meet school buses further up the road because conditions of the road may damage the bus. I mean, when the road's wet, it's easy to lose control. You know, drivers could get hurt very easily. But I'd also like to introduce Miss Teresa. She has put together a book for y'all to look at, where she wrote the governor, and she's also wrote the Department of Transportation, It looks like she got on the front page of the Andalusia Star News right here from where her she was sitting in the middle of the dirt road down there getting a petition signed wanting the dirt road paved. And I think she got over 141 signatures there. And I think y'all got all that copy in there to see what she's got there and all the other letters too. But she wants to say a few words also about how she feels about it.
Yes, I can speak from personal experience. I have a brand new car. Two times I've drove it down our road, it's tore up and went in the shop. So I actually drive 5 miles around out of my way to get down Presswood Bridge Road. I also have went to my mailbox before, and because of the washboard road, you have some people who speed to try to get above them, and those who go slow when they lose control and turn, I've almost been hit several times. And my dogs go with me, so I have to be real cautious when I walk to the mailbox for me and my dog so that someone doesn't hit one of us, because I don't want to see that happen. And that's just like Johnny said, when it's wet, you lose control of your vehicle easy. I've lost control of my husband's four-wheel drive truck before and almost wound up in the river because I could not, there was no way to get the wheel back to control it. We also have a problem with a lot of people during hunting season. They dump deer carcasses off at the main bridge. I've counted 7 there at one time. And then when we have 2 little smaller bridges before our house, they dump them at. And I also have some pictures to show y'all on those 2 bridges. One of them has a slight, probably maybe an 8-inch barrier, if that much, with markers on it. The other one doesn't have any markers at all. And I know that one lady one time had run into them, and y'all can pass them around if you want to. Her truck fell in on the one, and it turned it upside down. And if it would have had water in it, she probably would have died that day. And the other side of it, if you're coming to my house, the right side you can, the left side you can see, but on the right side, it is so growed over, you don't even know that there's a little creek there that has a culvert that runs across. And that really is a big danger to anyone out there. And we would like to see if the commissioners could help to get maybe some barriers put up, some markers, or something to help where people won't get hurt. And that's what we're pushing for. I wrote the governor trying to help y'all because I know Covington County tells us they're low on funds. I was hoping whenever he got on TV and talked about having the funds left over from the BP oil spill that he was going to give some to South Alabama to pave roads. And I wanted ours to be maybe the first, as you'd put a hand in the kitty jar, that if they did, that maybe he would donate some money and y'all would deeply consider paving our road to help us and the other residents who live out there. And that's basically about it. The rest of it, you have a book in front of you. I've labeled everything in it. It tells you step by step everything I've done, the letters that have been written, the responses I've gotten. The last letter I wrote to the governor, I hadn't got a response yet, but when I get one, I will be mailing y'all a copy of it. And if there's anything we can do to help y'all, just let us know, and we'll do everything we can.
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Rawls, would you comment on the alignment of the bridge on that road?
I'll have to look at Sally and look at the pictures and see what the issue is. Mr. Reed, I will definitely take care of the brush issue and get another board. A lot of times, which we put a stop sign up here probably 3 or 4 weeks ago. You've probably seen it there at the end of the bridge.
Yes, sir.
For the turn, but somebody stole that over the weekend. We just got it replaced down, I believe, this morning.
Yeah. Well, have you been down very far down the road where the other 2 little bridges are?
Yes, ma'am. The flat area,
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, because you got the one that's got the little barrier, and then I've taken pictures of the other one where it's got big holes. But like I say, that's a dangerous place right there. And if it's real foggy or real, you know, dusty when everybody comes by, I hate to see anybody actually go off in it and have to lose their life because of it, you know.
Yeah, typically we do have all these up on our bridges. People do. You know, if it's reported, we can put them up today. It's same with our street signs. They steal our street signs every day. And we're out looking. But if somebody doesn't report it, like I say, I'm glad you brought to our attention. A lot of times, until we inspect a bridge or one of our crews go down and see it missing, we don't know it's gone.
Yeah, there's a problem.
So,
yes, sir.
And just like I say, it's very important we find the stop signs especially. So if you can just keep us updated on whatever. But we'll get some more of these back up on those bridges for sure.
You know, years ago they put some limestone down on the road. I don't know, and it stayed for a long time without that washboarding effect that shakes your car, slammed to death. I don't know where the county got that from. That's good stuff. It might have been costly. All it was the best thing on the road for, you know, it happened in a long time.
It's a temporary fix.
Yes.
And we've looked into that, you know, the washboard effect. We get calls to about every Monday about the road, about the washboards, and it's just the gradation of the soil. You start getting, it's sandy, and I've talked to the commissioners about possibly getting some more heavier clay mixed in there with that to help firm it up more so you don't have that effect. That's a temporary fix, but it's something we might do.
You know, if you ever could get the funds to pave it, we wouldn't care if you started from the other end to pave, you know, I mean, just pay part of it, you know, anything
right.
would help, you know, but
right.
That's basically what we got. And like I say, so you got your books. You can look through there.
Yeah, and I have a long, lengthy letter that goes into more detail than what I've said. Y'all feel free to read it. And
yes, ma'am.
I invite any of y'all to come out right down that road, and you'll understand.
It is bad, and we are aware of it.
But I just as a note, and I always tell people, you know, we've got graders down. We've got an issue with our graders right now.
Yeah.
We've got some transmission issues, and we're having to swap them around just to borrow to get our worst areas hit. And, you know, we got roughly 670 mile of dirt roads in the county. And if you blade it correctly, you got to do it five times. You got to pull each ditch in, pull the lane into the center, and then strike off the center. Well, that's over 3,000 miles of pulling, literally. The continental United States from North Carolina to the westmost edge of California is only 2,400 miles. So that's us blading from North Carolina slammed to California and back about 600 miles.
Yeah.
Just one blading. That's something we got to do every year. People don't realize the extent of the amount of roads that we have, but that's the, you know, people say, why are they getting around blading roads? Well, the area that y'all live in, the guy, he blades about 92 miles of roads. So that's like driving from here to Prattville. That's his area that he has to blade every month. And that's just driving it, blading just one side up and back. So I just, you know, just patience. I know it's important. We do try to, and it's a highly traveled road. But I just want people to see the extent of the amount of trouble we have with our maintenance of our roads because we have such a large number. And same with bush hogging. We've got basically the same amount on just our paved roads as well. So we're having to bush hog as well, and it takes about three passes on each side for that. So it's an extremely large task to do. But like I said, I'm not somebody do the best. We do the best we can with what we got.
Yes,
so.
Sir.
But
well, it just seems that there's got to be a lot more traffic on that dirt road than any other, because it seems like a main drag from, you know. From
and we're doing studies, like I say, since we've initiated a newer way to approach our dirt roads, we're getting densities of houses, and we're looking also at traffic studies as well. We're actually putting traffic counters out and doing actual studies of the traffic. So, but if you see some tubes up there, aren't you driving 100 times up down the road to get the numbers up?
Yeah, run over the little counter.
Yeah.
Well, I know you never did that before, but I'm just saying.
You haven't thought about it, but since you
mentioned it. If y'all put a tube out there, we appreciate it.
But it's a large task. We do understand it's a highly traveled road, but there's, you know, the way the geometry of the bridge is, if it ever gets paved, we'll have to definitely do some type of permanent fix there at the end of that bridge. It's going to cause some.
And that's why I say, you know, I don't care if you pave it from plywood mill down, you know, just so people can get to their house
right.
And cut down on the wear and tear on the vehicle. But, you know, we appreciate y'all having us.
Yes,
thank
sir.
Y'all.
Thank you.
I'd like to say one more thing to you, Mr. Johnny. One thing is a problem with y'all out there. You have sand on top, but your base is hard.
Yes,
you're not
sir.
Making it so rough. And you go to a lot of sand beds, you don't have a foundation. The foundation is pretty soft, and so it don't make old Tater rigid like you're talking
it
about.
Does.
So that's why it's so rough on you like that.
Well, my daddy can't even come down there no more. Takes his teeth.
But listen, I do remember when we put that base you're talking about on the road, and not long after we bladed, I had a vehicle come by me at least 70 miles an hour.
You'll have to go get him. I ain't going to tell you.
He needs everything or whatever. You stick him in there.
Polygrip.
Yeah, polygrip. That's right.
As far as paving the road, this time we have no funds dedicated to pave dirt road. Hopefully a plan will be adopted in the future to adopt a priority and a source of funding to do that. But at this time, there's no funds dedicated for paving dirt roads.
We do have FEMA funds. There's a little bit of FEMA money we got. We could
put
some stuff on there.
Y'all get a grant or anything comes along, we sure would appreciate it.
I promise you, we get calls on it regular, just like Mr. Rawls does, and we have talked and tried to come up with a plan and a way of trying to, I guess I'm going to say, set up an account or a fund to put some money into it. It'll take a while to do it, but we've talked about just doing little portions at the time as we get money to do it, you know, and fix a little at the time. But it's a high priority road, I promise.
Just improve it, you know.
But the worst area really is from Zell Ready back down to the base of the hill, come back to town, from there to about Glisten Road. Is that the worst?
That's it.
Yes, sir.
So that's an area we could look at paving. It'd be going from dirt to pavement back to dirt again, but at least.
And also, the hill where Miss Margaret Zell owns her property, she, it's slick right there. I mean, it's.
Well, basically, from Zell Ready back toward town is the, I mean, from there back to Plywood Mill, it's not that big of a, to me, it doesn't seem that bad, but it is an issue from Zell Ready back toward town.
Yes, it is from that area.
Well, we can get Mr. Rawls to propose a plan as to how to address this in a timeframe. We do appreciate y'all coming and addressing us. Just want to let us know what your concerns are. Yeah, if there's no other comments, we'll move on.
Thank y'all.
Okay, thank you.
Thank y'all. Thank y'all for your time.
This time we'll have comments from our staff. Do we have any comments from the staff? There being none, we'll go into old business. Ms. Simon, will we have any old business?
No, sir.
With that, we'll move into new business. The first order is to approve the minutes for September the 14th, 2016 regular meeting, and September 28th, 2016 special meeting. These copies of these minutes were emailed to all the commissioners. So what is the pleasure of the commission?
Make a motion we approve the minutes for both meetings.
I second.
Motion and second to approve these minutes. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Uh-huh. All opposed nay. There being none, motion carried unanimously. Item two, approval of payroll and accounts payable for September. You have a list of those in your packet, and a total about $1.4 million. Ms. Sala, was anything out of the ordinary, or did you wish to comment on it?
No, sir. Everything's normal.
What's the pleasure of the commission?
I make a motion to approve accounts payable. Second.
Have a motion and a second to approve payroll and accounts payable for September 2016. All in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. There being none, motion carried unanimously. The next item is to consider a change to workforce classification and manning charts with CATS. A proposal was sent to all of the commissioners, and Ms. Bones, would you care to address this?
Okay, I guess all of you have a copy of it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, well, ALDOT pays 80% of salary for admin. So this proposal is just to make one of my drivers half a dispatcher and half a driver, because, you know, I'm going on maternity leave, so I need somebody to fill in my office. And then there's a financial breakdown of everything that if we were able to hire a part-time driver, the only difference would be on the county budget would be about $1,000, $1,631.
Mm-hmm. And I believe last year you expended close to $20,000 on temporary help.
Yes.
So by creating a position of a part-time position, that and with the ALDOT picking up the majority of that cost, I think $1,600 is a whole lot better than $20,000 from a budget standpoint. Plus, I'm going to ask you a question.
Mm-hmm.
Would the part-time help be more dependable help and reliable help than temporary?
Yes, because people would rather have, you know, the retirement.
On a schedule.
Yeah, that kind of thing.
With that proposal, what we'll need is a motion to amend the workforce classification to add a position in her department with the appropriate information in all the columns, and also to include amending Ms. Bowden's position. I don't have that number, position number at this time, to a slash driver slash dispatcher. Is that correct, Ms. Simon?
Yes, sir. Position number
position 07-02-02.
That's Ms. Bowden's position.
That's correct.
And in the description, it would be changed from a transit driver to a driver slash dispatcher.
Dispatcher, yes, sir.
And then there'd be another position, that'd be number 5.
07-02-05, yes, sir.
05, that'd be a new position, part-time. And for 24 hours a week. And that would also necessitate increase in her authorized strength from 4 to 5, is that correct?
That's correct.
Do I have a motion to affect all these changes as presented?
I make a motion to make these changes as the chairman has suggested.
I second.
Any other comments?
No.
All in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. There being none, motion carried unanimously. Ms. Bond, with this action taken today, you will be able to, Ms. Hall, is that correct? She could be able to advertise for that position. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Next item is consider a franchise agreement with Troy Cable. I would like to recommend that we table this at this time because some information has come back since we put this on the agenda that we need to explore a little further. You concur
yes,
with that, Ms. Allen?
That's correct.
And our attorney also concurs with that. So
make a motion we table the franchise agreement with Troy Cable, item number 4.
I have a second.
A second.
Have a motion and second to table the franchise agreement with Troy Cable. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. There being none, motion carried unanimously. The next item is discuss Point A Park invoices. There was a invoice that was presented to us about 6 weeks ago. The total was $20,989. I reviewed the invoices, and Mr. Kyle was in the meeting also with Mr. Johnson, and due to some items that are not covered under that work, it was two which are not included. We have come to an agreement of $16,626. That is the invoice. Mr. Johnson is asking that that invoices be paid, and so if you have not seen the invoices, they've been in Ms. Sowell's office, but we can get you a copy of those. We went through every invoice, every charge, and when we made the adjustment, we took off the sales tax that was generated on the additional invoices also. So that's the situation at this time. Most of this work was done on the bathroom facility and to make it handicap accessible, which we have an obligation under disabilities law, is that not correct, Ms. Cotton, to make it accessible?
We would.
So if he had not done that work, then we would be.
I don't know that all the work was for that purpose. I do know
I'm not saying it was all that, but that was part of the work. So that's not all the comments I have. I'd like to hear from the commissioners as to what they see and what they may want to do.
I hadn't had an opportunity to really look over until I got this. I wasn't aware that she had it. I knew that Ms. Cotton had done it, so I'd like to table this till we can have a little time to look over it ourselves. I just hadn't had a chance to go through it. And I would make that an informal motion.
Well, we have a motion. If I don't get a second, it will die for lack of a second. And we'll take other action.
No, I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to table this at this time on the payment of it. Mr. Johnson, we'll try to get you an answer by sometime in the next 2 to 3 weeks. Is that okay?
Sounds good. And I did send an email out to the commissioners. I hope they read before they make a decision.
I did get the email.
Okay.
I was just wondering. these and study them a little bit.
Okay, okay, we need to take a vote on that motion in a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. Motion carried. Next item is consider surplus of equipment for the engineer for the County Road Department. Mr. Rawls.
We'd like to surplus all of our motor graders. That way, and not said that we'll possibly sell them at a later date, we'd like to go and get the permission to go ahead and surplus those so we can look at different options. We're looking at a lease option agreement right now or purchasing option. We're still throwing those around right now. And we'll make a better decision. We're actually going to put this out to bid. The lease option, that'll go out, I think, probably pending a little more discussion with our ACCA attorney. We'll get those out to bid and then kind of make a decision based off of that.
If I recall correctly, I believe we did surplus part of those road graders at a previous meeting. Was it four?
I think it was four, yes, sir.
And you have a total of?
Seven Volvo. We'll keep the last. We have one John Deere motor grader that we'll actually still keep. But this the seven.
Volvo, what you?
Yes,
surplus.
Yes, sir.
So what you're asking is that be surplus for a possibility of them being replaced.
Yes, sir. We threw it in the lease for an actual purchase option. That's correct.
I make a motion we surplus those items.
I'll say.
That motion surplus the remaining three Volvos. You will get those serial numbers to Ms.
Yes.
Sowell so we can enter it in.
They're there. In the package,
yes. We didn't get the ones from the previous meeting, but now we have a listing of all of them, so that will cover.
Okay. Just in order to make sure the record is correct, we have to have those serial numbers when we surplus anything.
I'd like to say something about those Volvo graders. Mr. White is sitting there. When they first come out, it was good for the county. We did not have to buy the graders. We keep them 1 year, and we turn around and let them go back. They would just pay the interest. And at that time, the county was in a pretty bad financial situation, and it was the best thing to happen to us at that time. But it turned out to be now it's biting us pretty hard in the back end, but it was good for 10 years for us. Nine, ten years, it was good for us. But now we're gonna have to make something different because the thing got tight. No Volvos. And we don't have representatives no more. But it's hurting right now. But I think we won't be able to overcome this and. The engineer looking at us to do, I think it's going to be great. Get some good graders back, some a little more stronger. That's all I have to say, Chairman.
One of my concerns, if we replace all seven graders at one time in 5 years, you may be back in the same position you are now. So the commission may want to consider maybe purchasing two used ones, lease others, and then at the end of that 2 years, you get another lease, so you always have some coming due at a certain time, because if you had to replace those graders right now at the end of 5 years, you would be looking at over $1 million.
Oh, yes, sir.
So if there may not be a lease option available at that
right.
time, that's some things that I think it's worthy of consideration, but we'll get into that as Mr. Rawls gets more information, we can debate.
Yeah, we get these bids in, that'll help us make a decision, and like I said, like in the use option as well. So,
okay. Did we get the vote on it?
We did not.
Okay, all in favor of the motion to surplus the remaining Volvo road graders, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. There being none, motion carried unanimously. The next item is consider preliminary approval of road construction. Mr. Rawls.
This is the new Dollar General that's being built just south of town, here past the Southern Bypass. It's on it joins Cottonwood. The property actually joins Cottonwood Road, which Cottonwood Road is actually a private road, but it's going to be accessed off of State Road 55, and it'll be just a commercial driveway turnout that they're getting approval through the state right now on that their portion, and it'll basically just turn in and serve the Dollar General facility. But when they turn in, it'll be a hard turn left to get into that parking lot. They're going to do a little small, I think it's maybe 150 foot extension of that road for future development, and that's what this, that approval would be for, just getting a preliminary approval, let them go ahead and get started. The plans are, and I got the email, and I just forgot to get the thing printed out, but the plans are in order. It's a curb and guttered asphalt section as well above and beyond our minimum standards for a roadway. And I got to get the girl for the actual construction time because I don't know when they actually going to start, but I was going ahead and try to get the approval. So when they did, they could go in with the construction.
Let me ask you a question. The access from 55, Dollar General has to pay for that to ALDOT, right?
Yes, sir.
So in this access from this road, is Dollar General going to pay for that section there to go into the
Yes, park? Sir. Yeah, they're going there, and the right-of-way, they've got a right-of-way deed typed up, and the deed is in like it should be. But it's just it just covers just that portion of the roadway.
As long as they're paying for the total cost and no cost to the county,
no cost.
Do you see a problem with it?
I don't know. You said it's above standard.
Yes.
For something I'm not aware of where that's going to be at, Mr. Rawls, tell them what.
It's just right below the Giddyup and Go. It's just right down
where
on
that
the
fireworks stand.
I know where the
you know where the fireworks
just
stand was
about 200 or 300 foot past the fireworks stand. Just right below that.
So what you're asking us to give preliminary approval so you can execute a contract with Dollar General on this work?
Just let them go ahead and get, they'll, whoever their contract will be, but just go and give them, the plans are in order, and just give approval for them to accept the plans so they can get the road built, and then we'll take over that portion and that right away once it's in.
Now, this is not going beyond the Dollar General.
No, sir.
Just
it's a spur that goes into that for any future development that'll go in there.
Is adjacent to their property only.
Yes, sir.
It goes no further.
That's right. And it'll be actually a separate entity from the Dollar General property. Yes.
I make a motion we approve.
Second. Move on.
I'm all about progress.
All in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. There being none, motion carried unanimously. Next is consider approval for bids on inmate phones. Mr. Simon sent out requests for bids. Those bids were open on October the
4th.
4th.
At 10 a.m.
We had five companies that submitted bids. And after reviewing them, Ms. Simon has reviewed them, and I've reviewed them. It's apparently these two or three of the bids do not meet bid specifications because there was a specification that no other charges would be added. Is that not correct, Ms. Song?
That's correct.
Other than just what is charged for the cost of the phone call. So with that, I think, I don't know how many of the commissioners have reviewed all five plans.
We were limited, and there was only one extra handbook, so they had to check them out, and they have not had the opportunity to all review it.
So I'd like to make a motion that we table it till everybody else can review it.
I'll second that.
We have a motion second to table the approval of bids on inmate phones. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. There being none, motion carried unanimously. Next item is discussion of flood variance from Mr. John Carter. He has made a request about 2 months ago. Mr. Carter, if you'll just hold up just for a minute, I'm going to ask Ms. Harris what the regulations say.
What the regulations say?
Now, have you had any more input since the last time we talked about that?
I talked to state agencies, ADECA, but I have not spoken with the FEMA side yet. But I have researched the ordinance that we have regarding the flood insurance program. So I want to make sure that you all are clear on the obligations that we have said that we're going to take place to participate in the flood insurance. And this is just for the county flood zone. You know, that's what I'm above is just the county. Now, the cities, Andalusia City, they have different regulations, and this is just the county part of it. But for us to participate in the flood insurance, there is a variance that can be taken place. There's standards, but it all is regarding the property itself. You can work with different homeowners, land property owners, if there's issues with the land that it cannot apply to our standards, our resolution. But there are no standards regarding individual desires or handicaps or anything like that. If we give a variance to anyone other than working with one regarding the property itself, our flood insurance can be taken away for the entire county. This is not regarding one individual. This is the participation of the entire county. Is that clear as mud?
Yeah.
I feel bogged down.
And I may simplify it more than you because I'm not as knowledgeable on it, so correct me, but you had mentioned for us to be able to participate in this governmental insurance, we had to create this ordinance and we have to follow it to even be eligible.
That is correct.
And that in our variance, the ordinance that we created, it was adopted and it follows what the flood insurance program mandates and lays out for us.
Right.
And not to keep simplifying, but in order to grant a variance to Mr. Carter, would he have to, would there have to be a finding of good and sufficient cause?
Yes.
And a good and sufficient cause is regarding the physical characteristics of the land, so
of
to speak.
Of the property, yes.
And what do they mean by that?
Meaning we have standards which the BFE, the base flood elevation, it has to be 1 foot above that base flood elevation.
Okay.
If the land is on a mountain or hill or something where there's portions of it that is nowhere possible for, that's just an example off the top of my head, the land itself, there's something about the size of it or angle of it that it cannot meet those standards, we can adjust it through a variance, but it have to be some way that they're working and we're working together to still keep it out of the flood zone. It still has to be out of the flood zone no matter what.
So that first one is physical characteristics of the land would have to be so unusual that complying with that insurance program would almost be near impossible.
Right.
Okay. And then the second one that I saw in the variance was an exceptional hardship. Is that to the property involved or to the person when it talks about having a hardship?
Property only.
Okay. So financial hardships or physical handicaps would not apply as exceptional hardships under this ordinance. Okay. And what about increased risk in granting a variance? Do you also look at the public policy side of it as far as the health, safety, and welfare?
The risk would be, say that you give this a variance to anyone that comes up here that you want to change it. The risk is, of course, that we would lose our national flood insurance, but you're also the liabilities of other issues. And an example would be, which FEMA gives, is an example of putting a mobile home, not having it tied down. There's certain regulations that we have about everything in the flood zone. An example is a mobile home and us not allowing them to tie it down correctly. That mobile home during a flood is washed away, causing other damages to other homes around. Also, the emergency personnel that are having to respond to this incident, you're opening up liability after liability after liability. It's not just, okay, that mobile homeowner, we're helping them out. They're not having to tie it down because it's so expensive. You're adding other liabilities to neighbors, to other citizens, to the emergency personnel that's responding.
Okay.
And then that comes back to the county
because
we're the ones that granted the variance or did not follow the protocol that was there. So we are putting the county at a great risk by doing that.
Exactly.
As far as your opinion, was Mr. Carter able to meet the conditions for a variance?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
Okay, with that, we need a motion to either deny or grant the variance.
There's not a variance, yeah. Couldn't we not?
Do y'all wish to hear him first?
Yeah, I'd like to hear what he has to say.
Mr. Carter?
Thank you again for the opportunity to speak.
I would humbly completely disagree with it.
And I have highlighted your own variances that the county adopted. A hardship comes to an individual, it doesn't come to a piece of property. Can you tell me how you would impose a hardship on a piece of property? That's all I have. This is from the commission meetings that I think everyone has. Again, I would humbly disagree, that's her opinion. The first thing I have highlighted is the county commission shall hear and decide requests for appeals. It is solely in your hands. You make the decision based on the what's good for the citizens of the county. Conditions for variance, the variance shall only be issued when there's a finding of good and sufficient cause. If the physical restriction or future physical restriction is not a good cause, there's no reason to have these variances in here at all then. A determination for failure to grant the variance will result in an exceptional hardship. The example she gave, there's not a piece of property in this county that would apply. And then finally, I would ask you to turn over to number four. It says the Covington County Emergency Management Agency shall maintain records of all appeals and report any variances to the FEMA, Alabama Department of Economic Community Affairs, upon request. You're not required to report this. This is your decision. This is your sole decision.
Any questions for Mr. Carter?
And I would leave it at that, but you're talking about physical needs. I will be glad to sign a waiver that I opted out of flood insurance and let it be recorded on my deed. I actually have a recording on my deed for my mound system, my septic system. So again, it's interpretation, and I would appeal to the commission to look at the interpretation. I understand the federal stringent guidelines, but no one can meet these variances. And if they're not for the welfare and health of the citizens, throw them out. My wife told me to watch my language.
I understand that part.
Thank you very much.
I tend to agree with Mr. Carter about the variances are few, far, and in between. Susan and I talked about that. I kept calling her and saying, give me an example of where a variance would ever be warranted. And unfortunately, it is the federal law, and we have to follow those regulations. Even if we don't agree with them, we have to follow those regulations. And part of it says that a community cannot grant a variance from that conflicts with other existing federal and state law. So even if we do agree with you, we still have to go by what the federal law mandates so that we can participate in that program, which doesn't necessarily... You know, if I told you if it was on likability, I'd make sure everybody gave you a variance today, because I think you make some really strong arguments and incredibly good points, but unfortunately it is not in keeping with this national flood insurance program of what we're supposed to do. And you are exactly right. It allows very few variances.
There are no variances other than physical.
You know, the only one that I found in reading was about the drainage issues. If you were on like less than half an acre, you had some drainage problems. And if you could meet that other criteria, then of course you'd be granted a variance. And then they mentioned about the elevation variance, and it was very confusing, and it seemed like you may actually fall under that. But then you had to meet all that other criteria. So it's not that I don't.
Understand.
You know, I wish I could agree with you. This is the federal regulations and the law. So.
Well, are these variance procedures federal or local?
This would be a governmental insurance program.
No,
so this
here
would
in
be,
the articles.
In order to, this would be local, but in order to, they kind of go hand in hand. In order to participate in that federal program, we had to create that ordinance from what I read. So
the variance procedures here are in contrast to the federal program.
They cannot conflict. We can actually make them even more stringent than what the, I don't know how you could make them any more stringent than what the federal regulations are. We're allowed to do that, but if we ever conflict, this would reign supreme, is how I read it, or the way I understood it.
Thank you for your time. If you would, please give me a decision one way or the other.
Let me say something, Chairman. I think we need to table this and let the attorney and Susan and the administrator try to, and Mr. Carter, try to work this thing out and do what we can.
There's no way.
That's what we've done, Mr. Elmore. He came to a previous meeting. We turned it over to the attorney. And they have explored all the options, and I don't think.
In item C, it talks about going to the appropriate court if he's denied. Where is that? That way he knows where to go.
Tell him what his options are.
If the variance is not granted, Mr. Carter and I had been talking about that he would be the first person to actually appeal from our ordinance. And it would have to be the Circuit Court of Covington County. There is not a specific statute on point. I did find one, and I'm thinking you would need to give us notice, 15 days notice of appeal from the date of the variance was not granted. So you're gonna need something in writing so that you could give us notice to go to the Circuit Court. And I had told you earlier, if you got to the clerk's office and they don't know what you're talking about, I'll do everything in my power to make sure that appeals process, that we do what we're supposed to do so you can take advantage of that appeals process.
Thank you.
What is the elevation of your property? How much variance is there?
It's about 8 feet, right, Susan?
He has not given me anything.
I have
I mean, just about. I mean, I'm just kind of.
Yeah, I would have to go up 10 feet. I think it's around 9 feet.
Okay.
But for practical purposes, I would have to go up 10 or 11 for
right.
use underneath and so forth.
I tell you, it's hard to tell a man that he owns his own land and spends his own money what he can do on it. I mean, that's the problem I personally have with the socialist form of
I understand
of
the situation.
That,
I certainly don't want to belabor this point
right.
and tie up the commission because I do appreciate your indulgence in hearing me. But I just say it's impossible to me. The decision is yours. Would you not have recourse that this is a health issue and a safety issue rather than a physical issue? I've said enough, thank you.
And I have to say, it's not impossible for him to meet this. He just does not want to meet the regulations.
No, that's not correct.
You can build your house in 1 foot above the flood zone. That's not impossible for you to do on that land, is it?
Oh, sure, it's possible.
It's possible, he just does not want to.
No,
which is fine with you. I mean, that is your land, and you can do whatever you want to with it. But if you're saying this is impossible for our guidance to not be followed, then it is.
It's impossible to meet this variance the way it's stated.
For a person, not the property, but for a person.
For a person,
yeah.
Exactly.
And it doesn't
yes.
cover a person at all. And
I have a family of history of arthritis. My doctor will give me a paper saying it's not if you have arthritis, it's when it comes.
Right, and it said physical handicaps, financial hardship, none of that would be taken into account for that variance. It would have to be just the property itself. Is that right, Susan?
Which is impossible to meet.
Well, the other thing is, even though if the building was built 1 foot above flood, and he says he's got a history of arthritis and he's going to have a problem negotiating the stairs, he has another recourse. He can put in an elevator to reach that.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
So there's not saying that he absolutely can't build. It's just that there's certain parameters that's got to be met in order to do that. Unless any other commissioners have any other questions, I'll entertain a motion on this matter. Well, gentlemen, the man has asked for a decision. I think that's what he wants.
Yes.
And I think we are obligated to give him a decision after all this discussion. You may not personally agree with what you see the law as is, but I deal with those things every day in my farming operation. I have to do certain things in order to participate in a federal program. If I don't do it, I don't get to participate. And that's the way it is with Mr. Rawls, with highway funds. There are certain mandates that he has to do. He don't particularly like it, but that's the way it is. And until the federal law is changed,
we certainly need to change it.
Well, we don't have that power.
I understand.
So again, I I'm asking for a motion on this matter, either to deny or grant the variance.
To make this move forward, and I'm not for it, but we're going, if we will deny it, so you can, if you want to do your appeal process or whatever, and we can assist you. We're going to do what we feel is we legally bound to do, and we deny it, not at our, you know, not at what we feel, but what we have to do legally, and then let's move forward to whatever we can do. That's all I, that's the way I want to put it, that we will, I'll make a motion to deny it so you can move forward.
Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and second to deny the request for the flood variance from Mr. Carter. All in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. There being none, motion carried unanimously. Now, Ms. Cotton, would you give Mr. Carter his options after this, since we've taken this action?
Yes.
And she has. She's been very gracious, as has Lynn, and I do appreciate you considering this. Thank you so much.
Don't leave until we can give you something in writing so that you, that the variance was not granted, or I'll need to get with you on that, so that, because it's time sensitive, and you'd have that 15 days to give us notice of appeal.
Okay. Again, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Next item is discuss our drug task force. As y'all all know, we received a letter the first Monday of the month denying our grant from ADECM. There was a meeting called of the task force board. Mr. Meeks is president of it. They discussed it with Mr. Walt Mayer. The district attorney informed us that ADECA said that any money that was in the grant that had not been spent could be utilized for those same purposes as we stayed within those guidelines, and also that the forfeiture asset funds could also be used for that, in that as long as they've already been adjudicated. Is that correct, Mr. Mix? Ms. Sowell, have we not been paying that salary out of the grant?
Yes, sir.
It is covered in the grant, Mr. Meeks.
Right.
It is. It is an unpermitted item to be spent with the grant funds and
right.
The asset forfeitures.
No, not the asset forfeiture.
We did not.
Well, that's not what Mr. Merrill said. Question for you. You're asking the county to pick up that salary. What about the city of Andalusia and city op, who is part of this task force? Has there been any discussion as to what they will pay? And if we do pay her salary after the grant money runs out, are they going to reimburse us for their part of the agreement going forward?
At that time, had not had a chance
like anybody wants to see the drug task force disbanded, you know.
Do we have a line item for that, that we can use, we can, some way that we can pay that? We have monies available for that.
Well, it was budgeted based on assuming the grant was received, and we did not receive that, so.
They would just take an amendment on, but I think Mr. Adams wanted to comment.
I think since then, there have been some smaller agencies that have spoken about possibly contributing to that, and with the new administration's taken office, I'd like to make a motion that we do what we can to keep them in effect until January, until the new administrations can make a decision on what they can do also.
Also, I'd like to comment, the sheriff had, Mr. Adams, I thought they've had a couple of individuals to come forth and make some offers to help with the building and maybe even some of the operating costs. All that being said, that's a commitment verbally, but there's some things in the works to do this, and it's gonna take a little while to get it all worked out, but it's a vital part of our law enforcement group and a vital need in our community, and whatever we gotta do, if we can do, I would like to see it continue to the first of the year, and I think at that time we'll be able to come forth with a better presentation to keep it funded.
Yes. In light of possibility of other people donating to it, I'd like to suggest that we create a drug task force funds. All revenue goes into that fund, and then you as the task force would determine how that money is spent. That's similar to the sex offender fees. You know, it comes in, and it goes in a special fund, but it's not spent unless you authorized it. And if you do that, we could appropriate money to that fund, and Lucia could, Op could, and then y'all would be responsible for the expenditures.
What are you talking about getting the revenue for that?
I'm talking about we would make an appropriation to it.
What we've been giving, maybe some part of what we've been giving in donations, we've been giving, that we put in that
donations
special fund.
Would go into that fund also.
That's what we spent it.
See, we are a custodian for the honor flight. Mr. White is here. We're custodian for that honor flight fund, and it's only spent upon their authorization. We just holding the bank account. Is that not correct, Mr.? And that's what I'm suggesting, similar on this, that as we get funds in, it goes into this fund.
The problem with that is there's going to be more funds expended through the drug task force than the honor flight that does once a year. So we're going to have random invoices for office supplies and having to get them to meet to approve after whenever you've got an invoice coming in to be paid.
Everything other than her salary is still being paid out of asset forfeiture. The only thing that cannot is her very small salary, and we're really only asking at this time for that to be looked at for the first of the year.
She is temporary, so there's not any benefits that comes with that package as well.
Right.
So it would, you know, there's no health insurance or anything like that comes out.
Well, I'm all for it, you know, saving it, and that's what I'm saying. Do we have some way to do this? Where do we have this, and can we get this money? And that's all. I'm agreeing. I'm, you know. He's got a motion. I'm seconding it, but I'm just saying that we have some way to fund that.
Please state your motion, sir.
Make a motion that we continue to keep the part-time secretary on through the end of the year, reevaluate in December.
December 31.
And this motion is just to do with her. So all the other expenses
to
are to be covered by
just
forfeiture.
Just to do
assets.
With her salary.
Let me ask you a question. Can y'all request funds from that, say for to pay the rent and all this kind of stuff for the next 2 months, so the money is here?
They have the funds.
Or does it have to be?
Previously, when they used those funds, then the commander, Mark Odom, would send a letter in requesting to use the funds for purposes listed, and then they would send a letter back approving that or denying the use of the funds.
So he can ask for approval for
expenses. We are the custodian of the funds. in our two offices, but we can't use it unless they approve it first.
We have a motion and a second for the county to provide the funds for the part-time secretary until it can be decided by the all the entities involved to pick up their fair share of that.
December 31st.
Any other questions? Mm-hmm. Comments? All in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. And there being none, motion carried unanimously. Okay. The next item, one-way entrance commission building. We're talking about driving into the parking lot. Is that not correct? Ms. Sowell, you want to, or Mr. Kennedy, do you want to? But I will tell you this, where you come out of the yard out here and you go in with those trucks and all, there's a sign that says one way for all the traffic coming off of Hillcrest Drive to go around to the back of this building. And what we have is some people parking on that side of the building, they back up and go out that way, which creates a safety hazard for his equipment.
Well, for anyone, really.
For anyone. So the question is, we need to clarify what is the direction or traffic flow around this building.
One way.
One way is what he said.
It's hard to figure out, eh?
What the issue, I mean, a personal vehicle is fine. I mean, and it's been that way for, I mean, people's done it, it's been one way for 15, 16 years I've been here. But you get a large dump truck, he cannot turn because that island comes to a point right there. If he gets out there, he's already in the road. He cannot see over his right shoulder. He can look in the mirror, but there's going
to
be a blind spot.
Nice of this building.
Right here, yes, sir. So, one way.
There's really only one answer. It's one way. And it's been painted on the street for 10 years at least. And it's just like parking in Walmart parking lot and going out the wrong way. People have to be responsible for what they do.
Okay.
And if they're going out the wrong way, they're at fault. But when somebody gets hurt, it's going to be on county property. So how do you enforce this? That's the problem.
We got the sheriff back there.
Well, is the most of the problem coming from employees, or is the most of the problem coming from
employees?
Employees,
maybe. Put it in their pay to put it on the check.
If you remember, Mr. Kennedy, when we put in the external fueling for the sheriff's car and all, we determined that they would come in from the south and fuel, and then they'd come back and go back out on the driveway between this building and the parking. Is that not correct? So that pattern is already there. But we have, Mr. Meeks, we also have deputies going out the wrong way too, and they're supposed to be enforcing the law.
He said.
Well, I'm just saying, you know.
We've talked with Sheriff Meeks. He was not aware, and we've talked about it, and he's, I think, made all his employees aware now.
I think the safety issue is a big thing. Is that not correct?
That's all it is.
We had a problem with cats.
Do we need to make a motion of that?
No. I just think Ms. Sowell just need to send out a memo to all the department heads to reinforce this. Is that there's no action to be taken, but
right.
Just that we need to get information out to the department heads.
Okie doke. Nick.
It doesn't matter, like after hours, like 10, 11, 12, 12.
I don't know.
I don't see that it would.
Only if somebody gets hit.
As long as nobody gets hit. I mean, if we.
They didn't go out backwards between 8 and 5, they could have. But, you know, if you left them blocking out, they might.
Well, we may have an emergency situation working with a disaster. You may have people here all the time.
What about speed limits?
If you do it the same way all the time, then you're not apt to do it at the wrong time. We will.
You're right.
We got plenty of time, Mr. Elmore.
Yes, sir.
He's going to enjoy this one. This is his last meeting. He said he's going to stay here all day if he has to.
Who said that?
He put words in your mouth.
Okay.
I'm just joking. I'm just saying something.
This next item is discussing AG opinion request. I talked with Mr. Sonny Brassel about the redistricting. Our districting is unique in one way. We don't elect single, we vote countywide, but there's a resident requirement that you be in that. And he advised me that it would be very good if we got an AG opinion to clarify that, whether it's single member election or because of the resident, that qualifies us as a single member election. And that's what he advised me. I talked to him last week. So that's, I'm just recommending that the commission ask for that AG opinion on that redistricting, because there's a lot of confusion about it. Mm-hmm. Do I have a motion?
I'll make a motion out of fact, Chairman. Get an AG opinion.
I'll second.
We got a motion side to request an AG opinion on redistricting. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. There being we take the commission as it's elected and all, and we'll be requesting whether or not the commission has the right to redistrict based on our current makeup. Because there is a question between, according to Mr. Braswell, there is a question between whether you got a requirement for a resident to be a member of a district, but then you vote countywide, so there's a conflict in that as to how you may change that.
There's what simplified to me was we couldn't change any boundary lines because we did not vote by district. You know, you just run in your district, so we're running countywide, so we had no guidelines to change any district.
No, which is by statute, isn't it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And, but that's the question now for the AG.
That's what I'm understanding. We don't have any, unless we had a local act, we don't have one.
Well, that's not clear in talk with Mr. Brasley.
So that's, you know, I was just saying that's kind of what.
The other one was to request an opinion concerning expenditures at Point A Park, and I talked with him about that, and one of the reasons is that park was established with federal funds, not the state funds or county funds. Does that make it a difference that it's federal rather than, this is a question has come up, whether because it was done with Title X funds in 1974-75, and because there is a requirement for O&M based on the establishment of that park as it was put in, and the county assumed that O&M contract. And so that's that resolution, right? That's the reason that AG opinion is being quit is because of the federal impact on that park. So, you know, that's the question if y'all want that answer. We need a motion to request that opinion. If there's no, go ahead, Mr. Millman.
I'll make a motion to request that opinion.
We have a motion to request that opinion. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
We have a motion second to request that opinion. Also, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed nay. There being none, the motion carried unanimously.
And that is to see
not
that.
Unanimous. I think we already have a opinion from the staff attorney at ACCA pertaining to the capital improvement fund. That's
just capital improvement funds.
Okay.
Not, you know, if we can expend monies based on, because it's a federal entity created by the federal government.
So does it go beyond capital improvement funds for O&M portions?
Yes. It does.
Are you talking about using general fund monies? Is that what the
question
is?
As a possibility, yeah. You need to, that question has come up.
So I don't think it'll hurt to go and get an opinion.
Well, we just got to make sure we know how to write up and a request for an opinion to see what we're talking about using.
Well, it may apply to other things besides Point Eight Park.
So basically any county funding? Any county funds? Is that what we're...
Well, that's a question that's come up. But anyway, get with Miss Cotton and let her do the research and write the request.
Well, we just want to make sure we know what funds you're wanting her to include, though.
Yeah.
Right.
Are you wanting to make sure they include
be any type of
any kind of county funds? Okay.
Any funds, public funds, whatever. As you know, when funds from a private individual is placed in the bank of the of a public facility, it becomes public funds at that time. Mm. I mean, you know, Ms. Harris could donate $1 million to the county and say, I want it spent for this and this, but once it's put into the county fund, she loses control of it. It becomes public money and all the restrictions apply to it. So that's just part of the law, Mr. Barton. Okay. Resolution for amendments. I don't know what that's about. I have not been briefed on yet.
That's from the association. They sent everyone an email
asking
to support
I will let you explain it then.
They've asked for us to propose a resolution for us to support Amendment 14, and it's basically just stating that we are supporting this amendment and urging all of our registered voters to vote in favor of the constitutional amendment proposed by Act 2016-430, which will be on the November general ballot.
And it's supposed to correct some kind of technical issue that will affirm local laws that have already been passed. And if somebody were to challenge that technical issue, then they would have to go back and repass those laws from the way I understand it.
Yeah, I think what it was, because of the thing that says that the budgets have to be passed by a certain time, and these local laws were passed before that took place.
Mm-hmm.
That's my understanding, and that's so that you would not have to reintroduce all of these local laws into legislation. This just clears up, I think there's close to like 800 to 1,000 of them.
Wow.
So, you know, I would recommend that we approve this resolution.
I make a motion, we'll make a proclamation, to support Amendment 14.
A second.
We have a motion and a second to support the proposed constitutional amendment 14.
Or resolution, not a proclamation.
Resolution. Any other comments? All in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. There being none, motion carried unanimously. At this time, there is a need to go in executive session. I will let Ms. Cotton explain what we have to do in order to do that.
At this point, we need to go into an executive session to discuss the general reputation, character, and job performance of two public employees, and the potential also to consider discipline or dismissal of a public employee. And both of those, in my legal opinion, are appropriate for executive session at this point.
Do I have a motion that we go into executive session?
I make a motion.
Do we have a second? We have a second to go into executive session. At this time, I will poll the commission members. Mr. Adams?
Yes.
Mr. Elmore?
Yes.
Mr. Barton?
Yes.
Mr. Northey?
Yes.
Motion carried unanimously. I'm anticipating this is probably going to take at least 30 minutes or longer to resolve or to talk about it. It won't be resolved. So at this time, we will anticipate reconvening in here at 10:30.
Huh? Make sure you heard that, right?
We will meet in the, Mr. Sowell, is the conference room open?
Yes, sir.
We'll meet in the conference room.
I'm hoping we wouldn't have to come back in.